very much. I'm going to talk to you today, give you a snapshot of a project also funded by NCCARF called the Community-Based Adaptation to Climate Change for the Arawana People. And before I go on, I just want to acknowledge all the other team members. So we assembled a big interdisciplinary team, including two Aboriginal professors, one of whom, Professor Veronica Arvin, was also an Arawana woman. So that was a distinct advantage to our project. We also wanted to acknowledge the Indigenous peoples on whose lands we are today, but also the Arawana people, and particularly Aaron Stewart, who, as chairman of the association that we worked with, gave his unstinting support during the project, which, as Dave knows, was only a year, so we had to pack a lot of action into that time. The brief of the project was to fundamentally try and work out if we could develop some understanding of what the climate change impacts are going to be for the Arawana people, but also if then we could move towards developing some climate change adaptation options for the Arawana people. Now, the Arawana people are a group that are fundamentally, or their traditional country is in the Lake Eyre Basin. So for people from South Australia, most of you here, that's the country that's bordered by Maree, Cooper Pedy, Unadilla, and Port Augusta. That's basically where Arawana country is. But as a result of colonisation and pastoralism and also the building of the Garn Railway, Arawana people now also live in Darwin, Alice Springs, and Adelaide, and Port Augusta. So we find that in trying to develop adaptation, we're looking at not just building adaptation and understanding impacts in country, but also understanding that on a wider scale of how do you deal with that with a people that is now very dispersed. So what are you developing adaptation for, people or the country? We started off working with Dr. John Tierney, who's also a senior lecturer in our discipline. He assembled a desktop study on the current science around climate impacts for Arawana people where they live, so places like Darwin and Alice Springs, but also for Arawana country. I'm not going to go through the detail of that report now, but fundamentally what that report showed is that Arawana people and country are going to be impacted by climate change, particularly in the next 20 years. Aside on that, we also worked very hard on building in communications into the project. I think that's one of the distinctive features about it is we employed a former communications expert as part of the team. One of the things that he did was actually turn the science report into an interactive video conversation between Aaron and John, both of whom found the whole process of filming a little bit challenging, but we got it out there. And we used that as a basis to talk to Arawana people out in the field. So here we have a couple of Arawana people, that's Aaron Stewart, Lionel Dodd and Dean Stewart. They all came out into the field with us. We employed Arawana people and trained Arawana up as community researchers, so that helped facilitate the whole research endeavour. But we had two teams. One was the social sustainability team that went out and talked to Arawana people in all the places they live, as well as on country, about their wellness, resilience, governance and communications. So that was trying to establish the adaptive capacity of Arawana people. The other team went out into Arawana country, Darwin and Alice Springs, etc., and talked to Arawana people about the observations of the environment that they observed over time. And that, in the end, is like a 90-year period, because the oldest person we talked to was an elder from Alice, who was about 90, at least. And we also talked to them about adaptation options. So what are the things that they think they can do to adapt over time? And we ended that fieldwork by saying, here's the science. Because the established methodology is that if you start off with the science, you're going to actually give people a lead-in into what they want to say. Fundamentally, we found out that Arawana people have a long history of adaptation through time, and that there is quite a lot of inherent resilience and adaptive capacity in that context. But in terms of the risk perception and adaptation work, we discovered that actually the country itself is very vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. And this had a particularly in regards to water and also to livelihoods. So Arawana people are very worried. They're worried about how they're going to respond, but also in country, how they're going to build economic economies that are going to help them respond to those impacts over time. We finished a workshop, or the whole process, by an adaptation workshop where we brought Arawana people together to look at what they thought they could do about adaptation. And as you can see, we've got lots of different people from across the nation. And we ended up with an adaptation strategy. So this adaptation strategy basically is a community-based document, and the Arawana people have said what they want as high priorities is a way of building partnerships with other industries, community sectors and government to help address the water situation. Secondly, they want to establish cultural keeping centres in all the places that they live, including Arawana country, to try and help culturally revitalise the traditional knowledge about country and also build adaptation strategies. The third thing that they wanted was to set up land management centres and a range of programs to help build and work with in partnership to build those adaptation options. I just wanted to end by saying that in terms of the whole project, I think the real dilemma here is how you address social justice issues and social inclusion issues, bringing Indigenous peoples into processes like this. And how do you work on building adaptation when you're looking at people that are dispersed across time and scale and place, but who are all interested fundamentally in one particular time and place culturally? And finally, I guess the real challenge now is for Arawana to work out how to implement an adaptation process. They're a very new institution in the sense they got their native title determination last year. How are they going to move forward to build those partnerships, to build that adaptation in productive ways within themselves and out to the wider community?